Okay, my opening words today come from the Gray Hymnal, number 560. It's titled Commitment. People say, what is the sense of our small effort? They cannot see that we must lay one brick at a time, take one step at a time. A pebble cast into a pond causes ripples that spread in all directions. Each one of our thoughts, words, and deeds is like that. No one has a right to sit down and feel hopeless. There's too much work to do. By Dorothy Day. So now I would like to introduce our guest speaker. And the locals may be wondering, how did we get lucky enough to get a hardworking, outspoken elections administrator from Houston? Well, I have connections. I've been learning a lot about Texas politics over the past year. So Isabel is my daughter's girlfriend, and I've gotten to know Isabel and very impressed with all the work that she does. So I'm very excited to have her here today. So Isabel is the daughter of Mexican and French immigrant parents. She calls herself a policy wonk, and she is a native Houstonian. A dedicated progressive public servant, she has worked and served on many campaigns, commissions, and boards. She has a very impressive resume. In November 2020, she was appointed as Harris County's first ever elections administrator after serving under the interim county clerk for the 2020 presidential election. Isabel's goal is to build access for Harris County's 2.5 million registered and future voters, an approach that has led to the adoption of new voting machines, more data transparency, and higher rates of voter turnout in the country's third largest county. So welcome, Administrator Longoria.
Thank you, Ms. Cross. I think the part I'm most nervous about is making sure I make a good impression on Ann's mom. So the rest, hosting voting rights in a very tough state is easy compared to that. But yes, I'm Isabel Longoria. Thank you for having me on. And I just wanted to start, since this is, you know, kind of a faith-oriented group this evening, with my background. Both my parents, again, are immigrants, French and Mexican. They came from Catholic traditions in their home countries. But interestingly, both were followed liberation theology within the Catholic doctrine, which, if y'all aren't familiar, is a radical form or sect of the Catholic Church that I don't believe actually is recognized anymore, but sprung up in the 60s and 70s from they're your grandsons, Ms. Cross, that sprung up in the 60s and 70s from the idea of social justice, of breaking down the rules of the Catholic Church so that people could feel more involved in that faith. And really, social justice and good works were the core of liberation theology. And so I've carried that spirit, even though it's not necessarily offered. That has been my background that I actually think really informs the work I ended up doing and choosing to go into civil service. And to the opening statement by Dorothy Day, it's a brick at a time. The work that I do is just that. It's a brick at a time in a very, very conservative and difficult state. When we talk about social justice and radical justice, especially in the context of race and ethnicity and gender, in kind of religious access as well. And I was thinking about it this morning as well, that the core of democracy is people taking not only individual action by voting, but also that we have to take a leap of faith as a community that the decisions made by the whole will benefit the singular and vice versa. And so democracy in itself, voting in itself, I do feel is a radical act of social justice in taking this leap to lay your brick so that if each person lays their brick or throws their pebble at the same time, it causes a much bigger effect than one brick over time. And it's with that spirit that I've gone into civil service, as I've liked to say, and really focused on democracy. I've got other lives in affordable housing and urban planning as well, but that's a talk for another day. But what I really wanted to focus on is then how those principles were carried out by me and my team in the November 2020 presidential, and since I've taken office as the elections administrator. And even the creation of an election administrative office is a bit modern and radical in its own sense. In Texas, at least, we have county clerks that run elections. And that was a function, honestly, of white-only primaries in the past, of really closing down the access of who can access voting by having the records keeper of the county clerk, mandate, write, and control voting. And then it was split from the voter registration functions, which had to be given to, because of poll taxes, the only office that could collect money at the time, which was the tax office, and the office that would know if you were a landowner or not when you were submitting your poll taxes. So it's been decades and decades that those two functions have been split, voter registration and elections. And by the creation of an elections administration office, those functions are taken and combined now into one office. So it's one office that's accountable. It's one office that you visit if you want mail ballot applications and voter registration forms. It's one office that is accountable to make sure that we meet the standards regarding access and voter access across all spectrums. And so I'm really excited to be not only the first one for Harris County, but I am currently the only out gay county leader in Harris County and one of the very few Hispanic leaders, and I believe one of the very few who come from immigrant families. And so to have that for Harris County as the first in this office sets a standard for whoever may come after me, right? That it is important to have people who speak Spanish. One of our largest populations in Harris County is Spanish-speaking populations. It's important to have people that reflect those who have historically had the least access in our county when voting to understand the nuances moving forward. So that's kind of a big background on the office and what's led to this point. And famously, I'm sure y'all were all involved, November 2020, a big, big election. Presidential elections tend to be big in the United States. To give you some perspective, for local municipality elections, if it's just your local municipality, we get about 10 to 15% turnout. In here in Houston, so for our biggest city, we get maybe closer to 30, 40 if it's a really big election. And for presidential elections, it's been at about 60, 65%. And last year, Harris County, which encompasses Houston, Texas, had 68% turnout with about 1.65 million voters of our 2.45 million registered voters. So it's big. The biggest struggle that we face in Harris County is the sheer volume of voters. If you have 1.65 million people doing anything, it requires a lot of resources and a lot of staff on the inside to make sure it's done safely, securely, and fairly. And I can't stress this enough. Please note that the number one priority of every elections administrator is to make sure that our elections are conducted in a way that people feel comfortable with the results. Because in a democracy, if you don't feel comfortable with how the election was conducted, it breaks down the absolute fabric. And like we said earlier, the faith and trust, not only in the system, but the faith and trust in the decisions of the whole to affect the singular. And so I spent many nights awake trying to troubleshoot all the little fires that pop up, but I am confident in sharing with you that myself and other elections administrators, we held a safe and secure election in November 2020. Were there little fires that popped up? Absolutely. 1.65 million people are voting. At one point we had, when in our drive-through voting, sometimes people's cars would stall out, their batteries would die, and you had to go jump their battery to get the line going. People waited in line because of that. Those are the little fires we're talking about. So I get a little wordy, I'll roll it back here. So the innovations in Harris County, some of y'all might know, the big sexy ones are drive-through voting and 24-hour voting. The impetus behind those sincerely was that July before Chris Hollins came in as the interim county clerk, we had 6 months to come in and figure out how to do an election, a big historic election. And July were our runoffs for the primaries earlier. And what we figured out is, other places were doing drive-through and curbside. Our grocery stores, our banks, the movie theaters, y'all were living in that world as well. Why couldn't we offer drive-through voting as an in-person voting mechanism? And that's what we got to work doing. And then we thought too, what are other ways that we can stretch people out, not only physically in a space, by spacing out the voting machines in those indoor locations, by providing PPE, but how can we space them out temporally as well, which is an interesting concept. So we went ahead, one of the first in Texas, and I believe one of the first in the nation to do 24-hour voting, is just that we offered 3 nights until 10 p.m. and 1 night through the night, 24-hour voting, with the idea that there were medical workers, for example, who did not want to go to the polls during peak times or when large groups would be there because they didn't want to risk, right, infecting anyone if they were shedding or carrying something after work. We had late night shift workers who, regardless, historically, have never been able to get off work from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., which is when we offer voting in Harris County. And so they needed that 10 p.m. They needed that 3 a.m. And for me, the base core of everything is my job is to jump through hoops so voters don't have to. Is it a long night to stay up 24 hours? Absolutely. The trade-off, though, is that there are people who have been shut out of the system because they could not access voting because folks like me in government positions have said, well, I'd rather be asleep at that time than servicing people. And again, our philosophy is it's our job to service people day or night, any day of the week, to access their right to vote, because that is a federally mandated right. And I think truly, if you accept voting and democracy as a personal right, that it's a human right to preserve your access to vote. So we offer drive-through voting, which is exactly how it sounds. You drive up in a car under a staked tent. You got your own voting machines. We had staff for each lane of traffic, and each of our 10 voting sites offered 30 lanes of voting. And so people were coming in. 24-hour voting, we reduced it to 7 locations across the county. We staffed it with people who had not been there during the day shift so that they were fresh for the night shift. And all of our kind of internal resources were open to those voters throughout the night. And I myself made a point of staying up those 36 hours. So it was the 12 hours. But there were some other things we did that maybe aren't as sexy, but I think were just as critical for offering access to voting. Some around our mail ballot voting, we decided to mail applications to folks over 65 and attempted to mail them to all registered voters in Harris County. The idea again was
if you have a disability, if you feel that you are unable to access the polls essentially without risking your health, if you are out of the city or the county. So some folks maybe move to summer homes or other places, right, to get away from the big crowds of the city, or if you're over 65. And in Texas, we do not have online mail ballot applications. So the only way you can do it is by going on a website, downloading a form, printing it out, and mailing it to us, or writing a letter that has all of the same information and mailing it to us. In the 21st century, we know, though, that some people don't have access to internet to be able to do that. And even fewer people have a printer at home to be able to do that. So the thought was I would take on the printing, mail it to folks, and just let them know what their options were to vote, pure and simple. One of the nerdier things I'm grateful for too is that we redesigned our mail ballot envelopes. So before, you had three white envelopes. You had the ballot envelopes, you put your ballot in the ballot envelope, you put it in another white envelope that was the carrier envelope, and then you had to sign seal that and put it in the mailer envelope to send it back to us. These all looked pretty much exactly the same, had big blocks of text that are mandated by law. And constantly, people were putting their ballot in the wrong envelope, in the wrong envelope, in the other wrong envelope, and it would get to us. And the function of that is that if you did it in such a way, it would possibly, if you didn't sign it because you didn't put it in the right envelope, we might have to reject your ballot for not having a signature on it. If you did it incorrectly, if you didn't include other information, if you thought you put it in one envelope but not another, but forgot to put your ballot, it increased the rejection rate of mail ballots. So people thought they were doing it, they filled out a ballot, they sent everything to us, but because of our signature verification standards, which is the last kind of security stop for mail ballots, we had to reject ballots. So I took on a project to redesign our mail ballots to put color codes on them. So there's green, purple, and we changed the instructions to say, put your ballot in the green envelope, then put that in the purple envelope, seal and sign it, and put that in the blue envelope and send it back to us at virtually no cost, since it wasn't colored envelopes, just kind of color ink bars at the top. And our rate of rejection plummeted in Harris County, and the number of calls we got plummeted in Harris County because color coding the system made it easier for voters to use. We also enacted, we were one of the first kind of handful really in Texas to do this and do this voluntarily, is what we call a cure system, that our signature verification committee is made up of Democrats and Republicans nominated by their parties to look over the ballots, to compare signatures, et cetera. And what that led to is we then opened them up, gave them phones to actually call voters and say, hey, your mail ballot came in, but your signature is a bit off. Is there anything we need to know? Did you send in a mail ballot, right? Did anyone send this on your behalf? Is there something we should be concerned about? And the large majority of folks said, you know what? I had a stroke recently. I had an accident recently. I wasn't paying attention. And that's why my signature looks different. I'm happy to come in and verify my identity if needed. And with that coupling, and that is just basic customer service and reaching out to voters and trying to find out what happened in their lives that could affect their signature. We also have couples who they got each other's envelopes, which are marked by numbers, and we know who they are, right? But they signed each other's. And so the signature on their own didn't match. But if you went and compared their partners, the signature history would match. We were then able to, you know, accept those under limited circumstances. That gets a little more wonky and complicated. But the whole idea there is we met people where they were as human beings. There's some other fun things we did behind the scenes that I won't bother you with in the wonky details. So all of that combined led to historic turnout, led to people just truly saying, voting has been the easiest it's ever been for me in years, in decades. Some of the stories I love are that for 24-hour voting, we had actually, we placed a location in our medical center, which had never been happened before. We had doctors, nurses, janitorial staff crying and saying, I've never been able to vote because I couldn't get out of the hospital in time, regardless of those 12 hours. We had someone who had tried to vote by mail, who was living in New York temporarily, who could not, for whatever reason, I can't remember, flew in during 24-hour voting and voted at midnight at my location and flew right back out the next morning and said, without 24-hour voting, I wouldn't have been able to vote, even though I tried this other method. We had parents, interestingly, in the middle of the night who said, you know, by the time I drop my kids off, go pick up my kids, do dinner, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. is impossible. During 24-hour voting. And during drive-through voting, what we saw a lot is actually more women voted than men in drive-through voting because they felt safer doing it. And for being caregivers, most often in families, they could load up their kids, they could load up their families, they could load up perhaps older relatives that they were taking care of, and everyone could just go in the car, drive without having to load and unload people and go through that whole rigmarole, and that they felt safer doing that than walking into a location, you know, during the pandemic and during COVID. We also were very proud that of all the PPE, of all the regulations we put in inside, and what we had to do to even segregate people who were sick, but still absolutely had the right to vote however they wanted. We cannot attribute any kind of major outbreak to any one of our voting locations. And I'm pretty proud of that. You probably heard of all of that. You probably heard of all the wonderful stuff. And then you probably heard since then that elections administrators across the country, including Harris County and other places in Texas, have since been targeted. There is several conspiracy theories out there that either machines were rigged or there was big fraudulent campaigns, or that just by definition of wanting to do drive-through voting, apparently I'm an evil, no good person. And the difficulty now is that we have since seen, again, this wasn't necessarily done to make sure that anyone, race or ethnic group or gender was able to vote. But what we found out is that in drive-through voting, though Harris County is majority minority, so over 60% minority, that it is primarily because of those historic voters, right? It's primarily white voters who make up the majority of voting. But for the first time ever, we saw in drive-through voting that more of drive-through voters were of minority populations than anything else. And that matched up, and again, with closer to the demographics of Harris County. We saw more, again, women voting than do in other types of early voting. And we saw more Black, Latino, and Asian voters increase their voting if they were using drive-through voting. Same for the late night hours, the 24 hours. So if you take the hours from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m., which is what we were offering for the first time, again, an increase in minority voters, but most specifically, the biggest increase was millennial Latinos, who usually are helping their families out, working those late night shifts, working those third or second jobs in the evening, or taking on those jobs. The mail ballot voting is honestly kind of used a bit equal, but what we saw for the first time too is there was a slight increase in who was applying to vote by mail. And actually there was a slight increase in the share of votes that came from mail ballot voting because we made it easier for people to access that kind of voting. And so there is, now we see a racial impact. We see that we are figuring and getting over those historical barriers that have been in place for years and years and years. And then we got sued. So we got sued for drive-through voting, alleging that we did it fraudulently, alleging that the numbers coming from drive-through voting were off in a way that was suspicious, alleging that there were problems in drive-through voting. We got pegged for the mail ballots, saying that it was illegal for us to tell people about their different methods of voting. And that is the crux of the argument. They believe that I, as an elections administrator, should not tell people about what their options for voting are, that I should just sit here twiddling my thumbs waiting for people to magically learn about all their options for voting, which I believe infringes my freedom of speech, you know, both as a person, as an elections administrator, in doing my duty to educate voters. Drive-through voting, again, alleging that this comes down to a very technical piece of the law. In Texas, early architectural definition as well, can be a tent, can be a lean-to, can be a garage, can be a building. But on election day, voting can only happen in a building. So that would count as a garage or building. So that's why drive-through voting in Texas, or in Houston at least, is only offered during early voting because of that one little definition change in the law, which is fascinating. And so we've been, you know, over the past couple months, just like other elections administrators across the county, fighting this perception that somehow opening access opens up fraud, which is not true. Are there people who make human mistakes? Are there election judge or election clerks who, as much as we may train them, fill out the wrong piece of paperwork? Yes, there is always human error. Is there fraud? And I would define fraud as malicious intent, you know, to sway an election or to purposefully take someone else's identity. No, right? There is not that kind of fraud. There sometimes is, you know, one-off campaigns who do shady things. But for the November 2020 elections, I have no doubt in my mind that with 1.65 million voters, that there was not any kind of mistake that we think should have swayed any kind of election on a large scale. And that's the most important part. But unfortunately, the state of Texas and the leadership here has decided over the summer to pass some very, very terrible bills. There's no way else to put it. We've been fighting them since last April, and Senate Bill 1 passed just last week. And among other things, it says that no drive-through voting, so you can't vote in a vehicle unless it's curbside voting, which is a special thing offered for folks with disabilities. No curbside voting. Voting can only happen now from 6 a.m. to 10 p.m., which is a slight expand. Well, actually not, because voting was allowed for 24 hours. So now they're restricting the total number of hours that we can vote in Houston or in Harris County and across Texas. Mail ballots, I am prohibited from sending out mail ballot applications to people and, quote, soliciting mail ballot applications, which means that I am not allowed to speak about mail ballot applications potentially. I'm not allowed to add certain information on my website, potentially educating people on the right to use mail ballots. It's only if someone requests a mail ballot from me specifically. And even then, they restricted the methods that people can request a mail ballot. So they've eliminated fax and they've eliminated this other kind of wonky thing where they could email us asking for a mail ballot and email us a picture of their mail ballot application just ahead of the deadline, which would count. And then we would have to wait for the physical one for it to come in. They've eliminated that. So the whole idea is we did something fantastic. We did something, if I might say, was, you know, wholly in the perspective, again, if you consider democracy an act of faith and an act of joint faith, to increase that access, to get people into our group, to get people feeling comfortable about being part of the whole. And now the state is shutting down those options. And I think confusing people. And honestly, the motivations are not for policy. I was never once in Harris County asked by anyone who has written the bills or passed the bills what security measures we put in place, what the process was for any of these things, asked to come take a tour to understand how voting has happened. And by the way, we've offered all of these things, drive-through voting, expanded hours, sending out mail ballot applications, all the other wonkier innovations in the July election as a pilot for the November election. The December runoffs, our local May elections, and the July runoffs. And because the law doesn't go into effect until after Thanksgiving, you bet you're behind. We're offering it this November as well. And so that is my belief, is that I am going to protect voting rights until the very end, because that is my job, not only as an elections administrator, but I feel absolutely a complete holy duty to make sure that we expand access so that people can be involved in our community. And I will go out too and let you know that we've done some really fun things on voter registration. And that last year, November, for the first time ever, we teamed up with mosques that before we have offered voting in different Christian faith churches and synagogues, but that we had never before offered it in mosques because of the discrimination against the Islamic community or the perception that people would feel uncomfortable voting in a mosque. So we teamed up with multiple mosques in November to offer voting. We did a voter registration drive at one of the major holidays in this past summer. And we're gonna keep teaming up with those mosques to make sure that, again, multiple faiths are involved and have spaces where they feel voting, safe voting as well. And if you consider a Christian church or Jewish synagogue a center for a community, you cannot tell me that an Islamic mosque is not equally a center for community for folks. So I'll stop there. I know I took more than 20 minutes. I was on a roll, but I am at y'all's disposal now for any questions. And thank you for inviting me to let me speak a little bit about voting in Texas.
All right. Well, thank you, Isabel. That was good. I appreciate, you sharing all the work you've done in Harris County. I wish you'd come over here to Bay County and, set our election guy straight. Anyway, I know you still have a long fight in front of you too. Lots of lawsuits and...
Lots of lawsuits. And I didn't even get to the federal part. This all ties now into the fact that when voting rights were passed in the past, there was a preclearance state that under the Supreme Court, under the Obama, got rid of. That is what now makes Texas and a blue Florida and some other states not have to comply with federal minimums or not have to go by through the federal government first to make sure that what we're doing is not racist or otherwise discriminatory. We don't have that, which is why it's so important to reach out to your officials to pass a federal voting rights law now that brings back preclearance for states like Texas. And I believe, Georgia and Florida and basically all the other states to bring back that preclearance piece is the most important piece and other things like nationwide online voter registration. But I promised I stopped there.
No, that's fine. And Isabel's going to be joining us, afterwards for our little coffee talk if you've got questions and, comments or anything. So please join us for that. So as I extinguish the chalice. So we extinguish this chalice, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. Those we carry in our hearts until we meet again. So I hope everybody has a really good week. And after the closing song, please stay with us and for more discussion. And if you need more information on our upcoming services or information or anything, please go to our website and check that out. So I'm closing with a song that I picked that I think seemed appropriate for our talk today. So enjoy.
If you see something that's wrong, raise your hand and say that's wrong. Point it out and name that thing by its name. Don't stand by and stare. If it's wrong, it's your affair. Don't be quiet. Make a riot. Be a pain. Be a pain. Be a pain. Shout about it and complain. Ignore the crowd and go against the grain. Be polite, raise your voice and do us right. Be a pain, be a pain, be a pain. When Rosa Parks sat on that bus, she chose to make a fuss. She chose to break the rules and take the blame. Her choice to sit and fight helped to bring on civil rights. Because one strong woman chose to be a pain. Be a pain, be a pain, shout about it and complain. If they say you have to move, say I'll remain. Don't be polite, raise your voice and do what's right. Be a pain, be a pain, be a pain. Harvey Milk, he chose to run for the council board and won. Even though folks said you can't because you're gay. One brave LGBTQ elected leader ran and knew you can change things if you choose to be a pain. Be a pain, be a pain, shout about it and complain. Tell them I won't let you make me feel ashamed. Don't be polite, raise your voice and do what's right. Be a pain, be a pain, be a pain. Tennis star named Billie Jean told the world she had a dream that men and women would be paid the same. She refused to hit that ball till there was equal pay for all. She was a king because she was a royal pain. Be a pain, be a pain, shout about it and complain. If they refuse to pay, refuse to play the game. Don't be polite. Raise your voice and do what's right. Be a pain, be a pain. Kids from Parkland led the fight for something they all knew was right. They said it's time for us to finally make a change. If adults can't compromise, we must go march for our lives. They spoke out and led the charge. They all were pains. Be a pain, shout about it and complain. When you're faced with laws you know are just insane. Don't be polite, raise your voice and do what's right. Be a pain, be a pain, be a pain. Oh, be a pain, shout about it and complain. Ignore the crowd and go against the grain. Right. Be a pain, be a pain, be a pain.
Okay.